Fifth Estate. It was a Ponzi scheme that ran more than two decades. How did Earl Jones do it and get away with it for so long? The trustees and lawyers charged with finding the money Earl Jones stole have some hard questions to put to the banks. Neil Stein represents most of the victims. He wants to know why the Royal Bank, where Earl Jones kept most of the money, never questioned how he was using his account.
He would commingle everything into one bank account called Earl Jones in Trust, and he would simply use that bank account as his own piggy bank.
How is a in-trust account supposed to work?
When you're opening up an account in trust for somebody, it's clear, or it should be clear, to the bank and everybody that that account is not being opened for your own personal benefit, but rather for and on behalf of some other person or entity.
That is exactly what Earl Jones' clients thought he was doing. But instead of investing it like he was supposed to, he would forge his client's signature, then he would endorse the check and deposit it into his account. That's called double endorsement.
And I didn't know.
This is not your signature?
That's not my signature.
You wonder how this could happen. These are huge checks. These are large amounts. $100,000.
I know. It makes no sense.
There's no actual verification as to signatures, etc. Requires a lot of people to check checks on a constant basis. And the banks have, from my understanding, have simply taken the position that the checks that end up being fraudulent and claims that are made on them, they'll end up paying them. And it's less expensive to do that than to hire all the people necessary to check checks on a daily basis. Well, normally a bank does not allow double endorsement. He was able to do that.
And
he
how
was
come?
Able to do that because certain people at the bank obviously had enough confidence in him or his employees or saw his employees there on a regular basis.
And he knew with whom to do business. Jones preferred small suburban branches like the Royal Bank on Montreal's West Island. He'd been depositing major money there for years.
He knew his way around banks. He understood how they worked. He had worked for a trust company beforehand, so he was familiar and was able to use the system to his advantage.
You think the banks helped him? Could they have known? Should they have known?
More than red flags should have gone off from what I've seen.
And in what instances? What are the obvious?
Well, there are obvious instances when you see cash being withdrawn from a trust account, when you see credit card bills being paid from a trust account, when you see a debit card being issued on a trust account.
That doesn't happen?
That shouldn't happen.
I see. It turns out the Earl Jones in trust account was nothing more than a personal account, which he was telling everyone was in trust. Executive Vice President of RBC, Wayne Bossert.
What Earl Jones did was not untypical of an entrepreneur. They often start out very small, and so they start using personal accounts to operate their business.
The clients believed that Jones was putting their money into a trust account. Wasn't it wrong for the bank to let them keep believing that?
Earl Jones illegally used our letterhead, our logos, and other ways of implying legitimacy to his fraud. We had no knowledge of that. What we understood of Mr. Jones is he was an administrator of trusts and estates, a very legitimate business and a legitimate business for him to be in.
A more cynical person maybe would see it this way, that Earl Jones is doing business for over 25 years with your bank. He's forging checks, he's falsifying documents, he's running a scam right under your nose, and as long as he's not scamming the bank, it's business as usual.
Well, and I understand why there's so much emotion and so much frustration. He was very successful because he deceived so many people for so long, including ourselves, including authorities, including his victims.
Were there any alarm bells that went off before 2008?
No, we saw no signals that there was any abuse, any suspicious transactions to the account. There was nothing that would signal that this person was anything other than a legitimate, successful business person.
Well, the Fifth Estate has obtained a confidential document that shows the Royal Bank did, in fact, identify a problem with the Jones account back in 2001. This is an internal memo dated November 7th of that year, and it reveals that the bank knew Earl Jones was using his personal account for business and passing it off as an in-trust account. In the memo, it says he was warned, and I'm quoting, he could get himself in trouble because this is just a personal account in his name alone. The in-trust does not mean anything. But the matter was dropped, and the Royal Bank allowed Earl Jones to keep doing business as usual.